Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Grim Investigations, Arkham Horror, The Collected Novellas, Volume 2. By Jennifer Brozek, Richard Lee Byers, and Amanda Downum. Narrated by Todd Menesses. To Fight the Black Wind, Jennifer Brozek. Chapter 1.
There are events and people that change your life forevermore. It is rare, though, that we acknowledge these occurrences. My perspective, my worldview, my life has been so altered, I feel I must record what happened. I will always remember this week as a turning point. I will always remember Josephine as the catalyst for that change. It began, as all such things begin, on an ordinary day. I had seen all my regular patients. Then I met my newest patient, Miss Josephine Ruggles. Our first meeting was a study in power dynamics between patients and doctors. Josephine, heiress to the Ruggles publishing fortune, sat on the edge of an overstuffed chair, her back straight and chin raised. She had not yet become one of the anonymous unfortunates of the asylum, shuffling to and fro with slumped shoulders and vacant eyes. She still wore a fine linen dress of pale yellow that enhanced her warm, tawny beige skin. Her ebon hair held organized curls gathered in a bow. A small gold cross adorned her neck. At first glance, Josephine was a lovely young woman of good manners and quality breeding. That is, if you ignored the pale blue dressing gown she wore over her linen dress, ignored the darkness under her hollow brown eyes, and did not see the slight tremble to hands that clutched at the heavy silken fabric of a robe not usually worn out of the bedroom. Her malady, nightmares that left her bloody, seemed at first to be a common self-harm complex. Then I looked at the wounds. The mind is powerful, but I have never seen the mind create wounds like these. Little did I know her wounds were just the first of many mysteries I would face while caring for Josephine.
You do not believe me, Dr. Fern.
Josephine's voice was a smooth contralto, roughened by fatigue. It was a challenge designed to bring about a black and white reaction. Disbelief brought distrust, while belief allowed the patient to manipulate the doctor. I did neither. We have yet to begin our first session, Miss Ruggles. As Josephine pondered this, I noticed which drugs my new patient was taking. All were designed to give blissful, dreamless sleep. Josephine gestured to the notes in my hands.
You began when you read those, Doctor. You do not believe me.
What would I not believe? My patient had nightmares, despite the medication she took to prevent such things, and she harmed herself at night. Something in the way she said, Doctor, made me wonder what kind of encounters she had had with Dr. Mintz. Perhaps that was where her aggressive stance stemmed from. There was nothing specific in her records. Then again, many of his more esoteric experiments were never written about in public files. I kept the distaste from my face as I took a seat in the chair next to Josephine's. I am listening. Please, tell me what you think I do not believe. Josephine sighed.
The wounds, the words are on my back. You do not believe they were caused by things in my dreams. Even when they are in places I cannot reach, even when they are fresh and lined as if made by a printing press.
None of what Josephine was suggesting was possible, of course. However, in the beginning, I always allow my patients a way out of their fantasies, a way to prove or disprove their statements. I have not seen your wounds. I cannot judge them. Josephine stood as if jerked by marionette strings. She turned her back to me and opened her robe. With the almost soundless crumpling of fabric to the floor, the reason for the robe became clear. The back of the linen dress was stained red-brown. The rows of weeping wounds pressed their image into the cloth. It was even and regular. While it was unusual for patients to be so careful with their self-inflicted wounds, It was possible.
Malachi, he told me once you might understand, that you had tried to help him.
I twitched from my examination of Josephine's back and the hieroglyphic bloodstains and linen.
Malachi? How could she possibly know the name of my murdered patient from Providence Sanatorium?
There was no earthly way she could know of him. An itinerant man in another part of the state.
Yes, Malachi. I used to see him in my dreams. He is gone now. I have not seen him in a long time.
The beautiful woman turned in one controlled, smooth motion, another testament to her inner strength and spirit, yet unbroken by the asylum.
Do you understand? Do you believe me?
I did not.
She spoke to Malachi in her dreams? How was that possible?
It was not, of course. Josephine could not be speaking of my murdered patient. That would be ludicrous. She had to be speaking of another Malachi. After all, she was speaking of conversations in dreams. I covered my confusion by taking Josephine's robe and standing. I offered it to her with a gentle smile that hid the turmoil within.
Perhaps we should begin at the beginning. Pretend I know nothing. We will go from there.
Josephine stared at me for a long, timeless moment before she accepted her robe and slid it on. She nodded once.
The beginning, then, such as it is.
The pounding of my heart was loud in my ears as I took my seat once more. I tried to put the very idea of Malachi out of my mind. My patient was before me. She needed my help. If I listened close enough, I would understand her true trauma. I focused the whole of my being upon her. 5 heartbeats later, Josephine joined me, once more the unruffled young woman of high society. Despite her calm demeanor, the mask of her control was cracking. The unconscious flicks of her eyes about my office lingered on the windows and doors as if seeking escape. If I did not work quickly, I would lose her to the asylum.
The beginning. 3 weeks ago, I woke up screaming. Even as my maid rushed into my chambers, the nightmare faded. All I remember now is a spiral of symbols and a labyrinth of woods.
Josephine paused, glancing at me. I nodded encouragement, my pen and my voice silent. It was standard fare so far. Images of being lost or out of control. I wondered what had happened 3 weeks ago to bring this about. I would have to find out what changed in her life.
In truth, I do not remember these things. I wrote them in my dream journal. I have always been a vivid dreamer. Almost everyone in my family is. My brother Leland, he dreamed even more than I do. Such lovely dreams.
Sadness marred her face for a second, then disappeared back into that studied face of cultured politeness.
Even on the medication, I still dream, but I cannot remember what I dream of.
Her dark eyes flittered over my face, seeking something.
I cannot tell you why the symbols or labyrinth frightened me. I regained my composure and continued my day.
Her hand, with its neatly trimmed fingernails, petted the smooth fabric of her dressing gown.
Again, I said nothing, but gestured for her to continue.
Silence was ever my ally. It did appear that Josephine had a rich fantasy life, not too unusual in the grand scheme of things. The fact that her family seemed to encourage the fantasy in both of their children was unusual. They had clearly spoken of their dreams to each other.
Josephine's eyes glazed as she looked into the past. I thought it was a singular folly. Instead, I woke up screaming the next morning, and the next, for a full week. I did not remember these dreams upon waking. I forced myself to forget them. I did not want to remember. She paused. Part of me did. But I was too afraid to uncover what made me scream my throat raw each night. 2 weeks ago, the wounds began to appear on my back. First, one symbol, a word, perhaps. Then what I presume was a sentence to what you just saw, the paragraph carved into my flesh. I chose to come here for help. I chose you to help me after I discovered you worked here.
How did you discover this?
I noted Josephine had begun to weave me into her narrative. She assumed I believed the wounds to be writing. Alternatively, she was not willing to accept that I did not believe the wounds to be writing.
Dr. Mintz mentioned you in passing to Nurse Heather. I remembered your name from Malachi.
Josephine gave me a sly smile.
As I am here voluntarily, I still have a say in who treats me. I suspect the good doctor is unhappy with this turn of events.
Again, I suppress my distaste at the good doctor's experiments.
I would not doubt it.
Do you mind, though, if I talk to him about his findings?
I wondered if Josephine had mentioned Malachi, her Malachi, not mine, to Dr. Mintz.
It was a name he would know.
No, it was a coincidence, nothing more. The name, while not popular, was not unusual. She was not referring to my lost patient.
Josephine shook her head.
No, I do not mind. But I will not be subject to his experiments. I have seen the results in some of his patients as the poor creatures pass by my room.
Of course. I considered my words carefully. I did not want to agree or disagree with her, nor did I want to slam any doors.
Trust was still being established. I needed to make certain I understood what she was telling me. A clinical summary would be the baseline for future discussions.
As I understand it, for 3 weeks you have had nightmares, but no memory of what they are about. Is that correct?
Josephine took a moment to consider my words before she nodded her agreement.
2 weeks ago, the wounds began to appear. Were they always on your back?
No. The first one was on my side.
She touched her left hip.
It was a single mark. After that, they moved to my back.
Do they heal? I wanted to write out notes, but writing anything down would throw a barrier between us. I would go from confidant to doctor with a single stroke of the pen. Trust once broken is difficult to reestablish. I had to rely upon my memory for now.
Some, though they are renewed each night, I fear I will ever carry their scars.
Has anything new appeared in the last couple of days? If they had, it would mean her illness was still progressing. If not, it had stabilized. Perhaps with the knowledge, I would be her new doctor.
Josephine shook her head. Not that I know of. But my back is so filled with the writing, I would not be able to tell if there was something new.
The pain is the same. A single, widespread ache over my entire back. Heightened into sharp clarity when fabric is pulled from it.
I held my chin for a moment, considering. As a doctor of the mind, I did not physically examine my patients unless it was absolutely necessary. In this case, I believed it was. I had to see the wounds themselves, to mark them and determine their healing progress. It would also give me a better sense of what could have caused them to appear in the first place.
Decided, I stood. Miss Ruggles, I need to see your wounds. I also need to make a written copy and an impression of them. Will you allow this?
What will you do with them?
I will not know until I have seen them. It matters how the wounds were made. Looking at them will tell me.
I left the door open for Josephine's remarks about her wounds to be true. I also allowed her the dignity to deny me and to protect her fabrications.
While I did not state I thought they were self-inflicted, I watched as disappointment, fear, determination, and acceptance crossed Josephine's face, one after the other. She had decided that I did not believe her, but she felt my examination would vindicate her belief that her dreams caused the marks, that she had not created them herself.
I, on the other hand, expected to see what I have always seen, the torn skin of self-inflicted wounds made by fingernails. It did not matter how neat they were.
Josephine inclined her head.
I will allow this. My maid is waiting outside your office.
Hannah, Josephine's maid,
was a lady's maid in every sense. She wore a black dress of good quality and a white apron. Her sepia skin was clear and clean. Her hair, black with gray, shot through it, was pulled back into a neat bun. Smile lines graced her face, and she did not have the calluses of a maid of all work. Instead, Josephine appeared to be her singular priority. The two women were comfortable with each other and their respective roles to the point of a heightened, silent language. They understood each other on a level few reached. Hannah would go to the ends of the earth for her mistress, no doubt. Perhaps I could arrange a meeting between the two of us to see if there was something the servant could tell me that the patient could not. I locked the office door as Hannah helped Josephine with her dress. It was rare for anyone to interrupt me during a session, but it did happen. I wanted no mistakes. A hiss behind me caught my attention. Turning, I saw Hannah peel the linen cloth from Josephine's back. The maid reached for a soft cloth from the basket she had carried in with her. Another foresight of the young Miss Ruggles, no doubt. I raised a hand and my voice. Wait, please, allow me to look first. Hannah glanced at Josephine, who nodded her permission.
Pardon, ma'am. I usually bind her wounds each morning, except for this morning.
At first glance, Josephine's back was a bloody mess. Then the marks became clear. I peered close, focusing in on one of the wounds. Her skin puckered outward, as if the mark had been pushed out of her rather than scratched into her. As I stated, the wound became a glyph before my eyes. Then the rows of marks became sentences. It was writing. I felt myself drawn into them. It was familiar and alien at the same time.
Well? Josephine asked.
I shook off the train of thought I had followed and focused back on my task.
How could I have thought it was writing? They were nothing more than rows of wounds, not glyphs.
I needed to determine how the wounds were made. One moment, please. When one scratched at a wound over and over, it left a divot. I had patients who had picked their scabs bloody. The edges of those wounds also stood up. However, the edges always morphed with the healing process and the damage caused by the tearing of scab from skin. These edges were straight and unmarred. I touched a fingertip to Josephine's back, running it over one of the marks. Drying blood rasped against my fingertip, but the flesh beneath was soft. It felt as if this was the first time the wound had been made, even though the lacerations had been there for more than a week. This was not the repeated ripping of skin. This should not be possible. If you would, Hannah, clean each wound one at a time. I will copy it down, then go on to the next one.
Yes, Doctor.
Miss Ruggles,
call me Josephine. We are intimates now, are we not?
Though the young woman did not turn around, I sensed her smiling at me or at a private joke. As you wish, Josephine. Do the wounds continue to weep throughout the day? I wondered if she noticed I did not invite the same familiarity of having her call me Carolyn. Whether or not she believed we were friends, we were not. There were boundaries we needed to keep as patient and doctor.
Sometimes, the more difficult the day, the more the wounds react.
Thank you, I nodded to Hannah. Begin, please. We stood like that. The heiress, her maid, and myself, a tableau of concern. Josephine held her dress to her, preserving her modesty. Hannah cleaned each wound one by one and allowed me the time to copy it down exactly before going on to the next one. A heavy silence filled the air, not awkward, just anticipatory. As Hannah finished cleaning the blood from the last of the marks, more than half of them had begun to glisten and weep. I pulled one of my clean handkerchiefs from a desk drawer and unfolded it. We will press this to Josephine's back in a single motion, I instructed the maid. Then pull it away as soon as all of the marks show themselves. It would not take long for the fine white cloth to capture the wounds as a whole. Together, we covered Josephine's back. I pressed a careful hand to the fabric. The glyphs, the wounds, bled through immediately. With a nod, we pulled the handkerchief away, carrying with it a perfect replica of the writing that appeared to force its way out of Josephine's skin. Something in the way the blood soaked into the cloth pressed another image into my mind, blood forced through the skin in myriad religious paintings. As Hannah bound her mistress's wounds and helped her dress again, one idea crowded my mind. Stigmata. Whatever trauma afflicted Josephine's mind, it was possible, logical even, that her only means of expressing that trauma was the manifestation of stigmata-like symptoms. I smiled, relieved. Somehow, I had a possible answer. But I would need to consult with the good Dr. Mintz first.
Chapter 2.
After my meeting with Josephine, I sought out her former psychologist, Dr. Mintz, for any information he would give me. I knew from the start that this would be a challenge. Thus far, I had refused to link my research into hypnotic drugs to his research involving his dream enhancer. Had I known that his helpfulness was based only on what he could get from me, I might have refused to work at Arkham Sanatorium. With this between us, my relationship with the good doctor was strained at best and adversarial at worst. I had hoped to land somewhere in between in this conversation. Our meeting went about as well as could be expected. Dr. Mintz, I hailed the doctor just before he disappeared into his office. He paused in the doorway and waited, a trim older man who gazed at me with an air of impatience. He was not a friendly man when you would not give him what he wanted. While he was not outright hostile, his pleasant demeanor was saved for those who were willing to give him something.
What is it?
He stepped into his office and turned, putting his hands behind his back. Miss Josephine Ruggles, you interviewed her several times. I thought I would... He scoffed, interrupting me.
That hysterical woman. Have you not already sorted out the fact that she is harming herself for attention? Prescribe her some laudanum and send her home.
I paused, taken aback. Oh? After a week with Miss Ruggles, that is your only diagnosis? Dr. Mintz hesitated at my question and the tone of my voice. He humphed.
Well, I must admit, for a woman of her race, she is uncommonly well-educated, well-spoken, and well-to-do. She is remarkable in those rare aspects.
I widened my eyes, hiding my annoyance at his old-fashioned sensibilities. Her race?
Yes. You do not often see black heiresses, or even educated black women, for that matter.
That is not exactly true, Doctor. I kept my voice light. I come from a well-to-do family. It was required to afford my education. More than one-fourth of my university class was not white. As for well-to-do, when it comes to the nouveau riche, which many of the black elite are, it is the color of your money that matters, at least among the younger generation. The doctor humphed again.
Be that as it may, Dr. Fern, I stand behind my diagnosis of hysteria. Miss Ruggles simply wants attention.
And her wounds? I have looked at them. They are very regular, and the skin around them is...
She is talented, I will give her that. Limber enough to scratch all parts of her back. I do not know why she is hurting herself. I did not have enough time to understand that part of her psyche, and she would not consent to my treatment.
He peered at me, a small, condescending smile playing about his lips.
But if you cannot solve her issues, I would be happy to consult with you. Perhaps it is time we put our collective research together. It is her dreams, she says, that are causing her the distress. If we can get to the root of the problem...
I shook my head and stepped back. I would find no help here. No, Doctor. I do not believe that will be necessary. I just wanted to see your private notes from the interviews. Her case file was light on information.
Private notes are just that, Doctor. Good day.
With that, he closed his office door in my face. I adjusted my glasses. Thank you for your help, I muttered at the uncaring door. I should have known better. He would not help me unless it also helped him. No wonder the asylum was a depressing place to be. I would need to go to the records room and see if there was something else to be found, or, better yet, see if I could talk Nurse Heather into dropping a hint of what Dr. Mintz refused to share. I pulled my suit jacket close. Even here in the faculty hallway, the permanent chill of the building's stone walls invaded, despite the industrial carpet and the artwork on the walls. It was the only hallway in the entire building to be carpeted. This visual and auditory cue told visitors and patients alike that the top floor of the asylum was not like the rest of it. This was where the doctors had their offices and performed their interviews. Patients in this hallway were always accompanied by asylum staff. I hurried from the upper hall down the cramped stairwell to the lower floors where Nurse Heather spent most of her time caring for the patients in her own way. The odor of unwashed bodies hit me like a physical blow as I entered the hall. My shoes clacked against the black and white checked floor, stained with dirt and other unmentionable things. Normally, I could ignore the asylum's chill, its smell, and the dim hallway lights that cast unnatural shadows. I worked here to make it a better place for all, doctors and patients alike. My work was not for the faint-hearted, as I had learned during my time at Providence Sanatorium. But I could and would continue my work without falling prey to the asylum's air of depression and damnation. I had to. I seemed to be the only one who would. It was time to ignore my surroundings and put my task into perspective. This was no different than the first time I walked into a debate or an interview with a recalcitrant patient. It is always the first look that tells me whether or not there will be a problem. Whether it is because I am a woman or younger than whomever I am speaking to, the look is the same. I became an expert at recognizing and ignoring it at the University of Chicago. Unsettled or not, by the time I reached the first of the patient's holes, I had my pleasant, professional mask on once more. This was one of the open halls where non-violent patients were allowed to roam between their rooms and the day room. Most days I saw my patients in their rooms. It made them feel more comfortable, as if they had some control of the situation. I acknowledged Teresa, my dancing patient, when she waved at me. She liked to waltz with the figment of her deceased husband. And Victoria, who sat on the couch and rocked back and forth as if she were a machine. She nodded when she caught my eye, but did not cease her rocking. I found Nurse Heather escorting an unfamiliar patient back from the showers, one of the few locked doors on this hall. I believe I would recognize the nurse's posture anywhere. With wide shoulders, a rectangular core, and short-cropped graying hair, impossibly stylish in this austere setting, Nurse Heather would look at home in the latest flapper fashions. She always moved with deliberate intensity, like a woman on a mission. In my mind's eye, I could see her marching in a suffrage protest or dancing at a speakeasy with that same intensity. Right now,
Nurse Heather was focused on moving her patient through the chilly asylum hallway. Behind her, an orderly strolled on patrol, glancing into the patient's rooms. I noted that he kept an eye on Nurse Heather and her patient. The patient seemed common enough. Long, wet black hair hung in the woman's face, and she had the shuffle of a thoroughly drugged patient. I dismissed her from my mind. She was not my patient, thus not my concern. Nurse Heather, a word if I may. The older woman gave me an automatic, thin-lipped smile. She held the patient by one arm as she halted in the middle of the hallway.
What is it, Dr. Fern?
It is about Josephine Ruggles. I would like Dr. Mintz's files concerning her.
I'm sure those files were transferred to your office.
She gave me a frown and pulled her patient into stillness with an absent gesture. The patient tilted her head toward our conversation.
Not all of them.
She gave me a look, and I worked to keep my breath steady. I could not stop the flush I felt creep up my neck to my cheeks.
I see. Well, then I guess you need to talk to Dr. Mintz.
I would, but he is just going to tell me to get them from you. We both know how he is. She raised her chin to look down her nose at me, suspicion plain on her face.
I'll see.
The patient, who had been tilting her head up to look at me from beneath her wet hair, moved with sudden speed, pulling herself from Nurse Heather's grasp. She grabbed my arm and yanked us both to our knees. I found myself gazing into a single golden brown eye, bright as it gave me a gimlet stare. The rest of her face was obscured by her hair. Before I could pull myself from her, she shook her head, violent and distressed.
You must help her. You're the only one who can.
Startled and stunned, I froze where the patient held me.
Help who?
It was the only thing I could think to say.
I tried to get a better look at the woman's face, but she shook her head again, hair still hiding her from me.
One bright golden brown eye, lucid despite the drugs in her system, stared back at me.
It's within her. It was too much for me. Too many things to care for. I couldn't. She needed it. I didn't know what she'd do. The protection failed. You have to help her.
I put my hands on hers, keeping my voice calm. I do not understand. Whom do I need to help? The grip on my arm tightened, even as the lucidity in that single eye dimmed and dulled.
Don't make me rip the scales from your eyes. Don't make me. It'll change you forever. It'll change me, too. Please don't make me do it.
Then Nurse Heather had the woman by her shoulders and wrestled her into a standing position. I stood shaken and watched the patient. She reached a hand to me.
Help her, please. But don't make me rip the scales from your eyes.
Then she was in the custody of the orderly. The man wrapped a huge arm about the woman's waist as he bent one of her arms back. He propelled the no longer struggling woman before him with ease. With her free arm, she reached for me, muttering about someone needing help and scales upon eyes. None of it made any sense.
Put her in her room. Wrap her up until she's calm. Nurse Heather turned and cast an experienced eye up and down me. Well, that was interesting. She hasn't said that much at one go since she arrived 3 weeks ago.
I still felt the patient's grip on my arm, still felt the urgency in her voice, still saw her trap me with her gaze.
Who is she? Professor Sati Das, a professor of archaeology from England, born in Assam, India, to a British father and an Assamese woman. She fell into a coma while visiting some place here on the East Coast. She transferred in from St. Mary's after she woke and would only babble nonsense about shards and tomes.
It made a strange sort of sense. Her British accent had been tinged with a foreigner's timber.
What did she mean by rip the scales from my eyes? Has she said this sort of thing before? And whom does she want people to help?
I held my arm to my body,
it still throbbed with the patient's strength of purpose.
I don't know the answer to your questions. She never said such to me.
The nurse gave me a cursory look, manipulating my wrist, then my elbow.
You're fine. You're going to bruise, but that's all.
Nurse Heather adjusted her nurse's cap.
It's strange. She's usually so calm.
I rubbed my arm, trying to banish the feel of Sati's cold hand from it. Probably the malady she suffers from. We have never seen each other before. Who is her doctor?
Dr. Mintz is in charge of her treatment. She's a possible candidate for his dream enhancer.
Nurse Heather gazed at me.
I'll have to tell him of her reaction to you when I get those records you want.
I nodded, knowing that Dr. Mintz would deny the nurse, or give her copies of the useless information he had already sent over.
Of course. Perhaps it's something about you, your hair color or your glasses, that struck such a chord in her.
The head nurse continued to peer at me as if I were an interesting bug.
Perhaps, I agreed, suppressing a shudder. Thank you for getting those files for me.
I gave her a nod and turned on my heel. Nurse Heather did not stop me as I hurried away, although I felt her keen gaze on my back. What else was she going to tell the good doctor about the strange encounter? Returning to the safety of my office, grateful for the scant warmth within and the familiarity of my books, I was torn between my current case and the encounter with the professor. Why had she reacted so? Shaking my head to clear it of the patient who was not mine, I turned to my notes of Josephine Ruggles. I peered at the copy I had made of the wounds and compared them with the handkerchief impression. The marks on Josephine's back, they look so near to writing. Perhaps a cross between Sanskrit and Arabic, something old, a forgotten dialect? Was it possible to have a case of stigmata that resulted in written words on the skin? I had too many questions and no answers. In the meantime, I had to consider my treatment of Josephine for her nightmares. Whether the wounds were self-inflicted or stigmata-like symptoms, it was possible, probable even, that she would respond to my hypnotic sessions. The root of her problem was within her mind. I was sure of this. Ransacking my reference books, I found only one mention of non-Christian-based stigmata, bleeding from the scalp, palms, side, and/or wrist, in a much older non-medical book from the early 1800s. It was obvious that I would not find such a book in the small asylum reference library. I would need to go to the university library for a chance to find it or something comparable. It had been a while since I visited the Orne Library. Perhaps it held the key to Josephine's malady.
Chapter 3.
I grew up moving about the United States. My father was a railman and traveled from station to station, inspecting, improving, and managing them until they met Union Pacific standards. Then we moved on. The longest we remained in a single location was 2 years. This travel allowed me to discover and fall in love with the University of Chicago, one of the more progressive universities when it came to women. I completed my undergraduate work with distinction and an open mind that many on the East Coast do not possess. By the time I was ready for my graduate work, my family had settled down in Boston, Massachusetts. This allowed me to choose Pembroke College for my continued studies. I wanted to be close to my family. Throughout my university years, I had occasion to visit the Orne Library at Miskatonic University in search of research material for my thesis. The University of Chicago has a wonderful library, as does Pembroke College, filled to the brim with books. But it does not have the sensibility, the atmosphere, or the reverence for books that the Orne Library possesses. It is the kind of library bibliotaphs dream of, with its dark woods, huge stacks,
and quiet atmosphere. Entering Miskatonic University's Orne Library was like walking onto hallowed ground. A preternatural hush lay over the large, open room, and the scent of old books permeated the air. Even my steps against the marbled floor were muted. I sighed a happy sigh. This library was home. My feet knew the way to the card catalog. I slipped through the large wooden tables and nodded to the reference librarian, Ms. Meyer. If I could not find what I wanted, I would ask her. However, the librarian had taught me that I needed to search on my own first, because it was likely I would come across something I had not considered before. My first round of catalog searching did bear fruit, although I was uncertain if any of it would be useful. I had 4 books to begin with. 5 Wounds, The First Case of Stigmata by Davidson, 1720. The Phenomena of Stigmata, Divine and Diabolic, by Spring and Mayhew, 1895. Stigmata, An Investigation by Hunt and Mead, 1901. The Miracle of Stigmata by Harrington, 1910. Although none of them were medical in nature, they would begin to give me an idea of whether or not Josephine's marks could be from stigmata. While I was collecting the 4 books, I chanced upon one called Written in Blood by Sutherland and Drury Crusett, 1919. It was new and, at first glance, appeared to be far more analytical than the first 4 books. I added it to my pile. When I returned to the large wooden tables, I found myself choosing what had once been my usual seat, a table in the back corner that gave me a good view of the rest of the room, one that would limit the number of people walking behind me. As progressive as both my universities were, that did not stop some of the less enlightened of my peers from pranking the women of my class. Twice I had water dumped on me from behind while I was in the library doing research, hours of work ruined. Twice I walked back to my room, soaked and flushed with classmates snickering behind my back. Twice was enough. I learned to sit where I could watch the room, the people, and my back. Hours later, I had pages of notes on stigmata, but I was not sure if any of it would assist me with Josephine. There were no cases of stigmata appearing while the sufferer slept. There were no cases, or even stories, of the stigmata wounds spelling out words in any language, not even stories of stigmata making a design within the flesh. All the research, if you could call it that, was steeped in religious mysticism and always led back to the Christ figure. Even the promising Written in Blood book came up empty, with the exception of referencing another book, Anomalistic, Thinking in Regards to Miracles by Avi Zunger, a Jewish scholar. There was no date given for the book, and I could not find it in the card catalog. It was time to see Ms. Mayer. I approached the reference desk with the same quiet reverence one gives respected professors. A librarian is the caretaker of the books and knows their secrets. Treat both well, and you will be rewarded with knowledge. That was what I needed now. Ms. Mayer was an older woman. Her thick hair, held at the nape of her neck in a chignon, was more gray than black. She wore an impeccable polka-dotted dress and a sweater. She also had reading glasses on a long chain about her neck. Ms. Mayer waited until I was at the reference desk to look up. Her eyes brightened with familiarity.
Ms. Fern, I saw you come in. Is it doctor now?
Doctor, I confirmed.
Well done.
Thank you.
What may I do for you?
I am looking for this book.
I showed her the book's name and author. However, it does not seem to be in the card catalog. It was mentioned in another book as reference material for the psychology behind miracles and magical thinking in regards to stigmata. The librarian looked away for a long, silent moment, consulting her mental card catalog. She nodded to herself.
If we have it, there are a couple of places it could be. I won't be long.
With that, she left me at the reference desk. I knew better than to follow her around like a lost puppy. Instead, I returned the books I pulled to their rightful places within the stacks. I also gathered up my things. Either Miss Mayer would find what I needed, or I would be done here. By the time I returned to the reference desk, the librarian was waiting for me. She was bent over a large tome of handwritten notes, a ledger, perhaps, or a manifest. I waited quietly until she straightened.
This is an interesting book you've requested. It's in the rare book room.
I see. Will I be allowed to look at it? I was not certain. As one of the visiting staff from the asylum, I was permitted some access to the library, but I was not sure what privileges that afforded me. Ms. Mayer nodded.
Yes, but you will be required to stay within the rare book room and to use cotton gloves. I trust you have some?
Yes, ma'am, I do. I showed her my gloved hands. I had kept the habit of storing cotton gloves, along with my usual gloves, in my handbag at all times, a holdover from spending many hours working with pen and paper at the university. Of course, I wore gloves outside of the asylum, but such formality was not needed within it. She wrote something on a note card.
The rare book room is on the second floor to your left, at the end of the hallway. Keep that card with you. It is both reference and,
she gave me a knowing smile,
a permission slip to be in the room. You will find what you seek on the third bookcase, the second shelf. While it isn't particularly old, it is rare and fragile. Do be careful.
I knew the admonishment was automatic. Of course. Thank you for your help.
You're welcome. Remember that the library closes at 7 tonight, sharp.
I shall remember. As I turned toward the stairs, I glanced at my watch. It was already just past 5. I had been here for hours without realizing how much time had passed. That was the way research was. But my patient list was light, and my duties would continue in the morning. For now, I was on the trail of something that might help my newest patient. At the end of the second floor hallway stood an imposing set of double doors. Above the doors, a sign proclaimed this to be the Ruggles Rare Book Room. To the side of the closed doors, a gold and black plaque hung at eye level. I approached it with wary curiosity.
Dedicated to Thomas Ruggles, 1846 to 1918. In honor of his dedication to the printed word and his lifelong commitment to spreading knowledge to one and all. In remembrance of his generous support to the Orne Library. A man faithful to his family, friends, and community. His loss reminds us how important it is for the librarian to guide the novice, transmit culture, and provide information in times of chaos. He will be missed. In loving memory, Alonzo and Nina Ruggles.
I touched the raised bronze letters of the last two names. Alonzo and Nina were the names of Josephine's parents. At first blush, it appeared to be an unbelievable coincidence. Then I remembered that Josephine was the heiress to the Ruggles publishing fortune. Of course, her grandfather, if that was who Thomas Ruggles was, and her parents supported the university and its library. I opened the doors to the rare book room and took a breath, looking around. Rather than the grays and whites and dark wood of the lower floor, this room was decorated in lighter shades of brown and beige. I turned up the lights. Heavy russet drapes blocked all natural light from the delicate books. The temperature was cool but dry. I closed the doors to preserve the climate. Ochre bookcases with glass fronts lined the walls with two sets of standing shelves that stood alongside three large tables. Each set of shelves had a brass number on top of it. So much esoteric knowledge. It made my head spin. Even the floor was a mixture of light and dark woods in a spiraling pattern, a striking contrast to the lower level's marble floor. Knowing that time was of the essence, I moved to the third bookcase and opened the glass doors. Each of them could be locked, it seemed, and I wondered if the librarians locked the shelves or just the rare bookroom door at night. The unmistakable scent of antique books greeted me like an old friend. Even as I scanned the second shelf for the book I wanted, I noticed that there was no dust. The librarians tended this room and its valuable contents well. My treasure found, I settled in at one of the tables to read. Anomalistic Thinking in Regards to Miracles by Avi Zunger had been written in Hebrew and translated into English. Most likely, this had been a student's graduate project. Written from back to front, a page of neatly typed English translation had been stuck between the book's pages with marks of corresponding work in the original writing. The student had probably been a linguistics major rather than a philosophy or psychology student. I dug into the text. Avi Zunger had an interesting way of explaining the mental calisthenics the mind went through to accept the impossible. While a child could accept everything presented, no matter how improbable, Zunger questioned what could cause an adult to do the same. Perhaps there was a bound translation of the book I could order. It would be an expensive indulgence, but this book belonged in my personal library as valuable reference material. Even as the minutes ticked by and I wrote out notes to consider when approaching Josephine and her wounds, I wondered if I had accepted the idea of stigmata too easily. I rolled this idea over and over in my mind as I gazed at the floor. Something about it was familiar and alien. My vision blurred. I'd stopped taking notes, stopped reading the text. The wooden pattern spiraled and undulated as if alive. The darker, russet brown shapes morphed and flowed through the wood in a way not dissimilar to the marks on Josephine's back. I pulled the note of the three symbols I'd scrolled as reference from my handbag and held it up just left of my eyes. As I compared the design of the floor to the symbols, I let my eyes relax. The marks on the floor and my note blurred in the same manner, almost becoming one design. Was this room somehow related to my patient's malady? I considered the answer as I put the paper away. Of course, Josephine would have seen this room when it was dedicated to her family member. Of course, it would have affected her. Was all this a delayed response of grief to her grandfather's passing? I would have to talk to her about this. What had her relationship been with Thomas Ruggles? And why would it have taken more than 2 years for the grief to manifest in such an overt and bloody manner? Checking my watch, I saw it was already 6:30. I needed to clean up and bid Ms. Mayer a good evening. Perhaps she would know who the designer of this room was, and I would be able to link the marks on Josephine's back to her grandfather through the designer.
Chapter 4.
Hypnotic therapy is not for all my patients. Many are too untrusting, temperamental, or unwilling to relax enough to explore their inner thoughts through the guided technique. For a patient like that, I use a more standard set of psychological tools to get to the heart of their malady, if it is possible. My hypnotic therapy technique came about after much research and thought. The essence of the matter is that many patients cannot face their trauma in the cold, hard light of day. But in a relaxed, sleepy, hypnotic state, the inner child, or critic, loosens its hold and allows them to examine their trauma with a more objective mind. I was fortunate that the chemist at Providence Sanatorium was willing to converse with me and come up with the concoction that I use today. The sedative relaxes both the body and the mind without causing blackouts. It is enough to still the discomfort of those unable to relax and open the mind to suggestion, allowing the patient to be led down difficult paths to examine their own fear and trauma. They remain just conscious enough to be aware of me, my guiding authority, and my representation of safety. This is what I had decided Josephine needed. I was right. With the sun high in the sky, Josephine was the last of my patients I was to see today. I pulled the drapes closed as Josephine settled in. She looked as neat as she had yesterday, in a pale blue dress and a sweater, but the hollows beneath her eyes were deeper, darker, and more haunted. She watched me with a curious gaze but said nothing. I had to prompt her into conversation again. "How are you?" "Did I have the nightmare last night?" "Yes." "Did I bleed again?" "Yes." "Am I in pain?" "No, no more than usual." The heiress gestured to the room. "The office is set up in a different manner than yesterday." I knew she referred to the sitting area of the office in specific. Her abrupt manner and immediate change of topic said just how bad last night had been. Weary and wary, Josephine hurt. "Yes, the setup is new for you, but this is how I arrange things for almost all my hypnotherapy sessions. It is a visual cue for your subconscious as much as it is for comfort and utility." The two overstuffed armchairs sat across from each other with the coffee table just to the side. The low table held my papers from her file, my examination notes, and the library research. The sedative I liked to use, syringe and drug bottle, sat on top of it all next to my light enhancer. I sat down across from her. We were very close, with our knees no more than a couple of hand breaths apart. This closeness inspired trust and honesty for some patients, like Josephine. Others, I had to sit much farther away. "After some careful thought, I have some ideas about your case. Have you experienced anything tragic in the last couple of years? A loss, perhaps?" Josephine considered this for a long moment. "I have had losses, yes. Though I cannot think of anything I would consider tragic." "The loss of a family member or a childhood friend?" She shook her head. "Not in the last couple of years." Repression was a natural reaction to the pain of losing a loved one. It was not unusual for my patients to be unaware of both their loss and the mark it left on their psyche. "I believe your wounds may be a unique case of stigmata-like symptoms born of grief." Josephine watched me, waiting for me to elaborate. When I did not, her rigid posture relaxed. "Grief? Who am I grieving for?" "Grief," I confirmed. "We will speak of that soon." Her face shifted from confusion to surprise and grateful relief. "You believe me? I did not harm myself?" "I believe you." Josephine had dismissed the idea she was suffering from grief because I might actually believe her. This relief and gratitude would make her much more amenable to our hypnotherapy session. I would need to use this. Another note of interest. Until this moment, she had not used a contraction with me. Perhaps it was a sign of high emotion. I would watch for it and determine its trigger. Unconscious mannerisms rarely lied, even when the patient was guarded. I gave myself a mental note to notice any and all contraction she used. Josephine closed her eyes. "Thank you." "You are aware I use hypnotherapy with my patients to get to the roots of their problems?" She nodded. "I would like to use this technique on you." "What does it require?" Suspicion returned to her voice and stiffened her posture as she opened her eyes once more.
What will it feel like? It sounds unusual.
It is unusual. Odd and strange. Some of my colleagues have called me crazy. However, they cannot deny my results or my number of cured patients. I shrugged. It requires nothing from you except your willingness to proceed. You cannot hypnotize a person who does not wish to be. They must be willing.
I gestured to the syringe and bottle of clear liquid.
This is a sedative. Again, it is not required, but it does relax the patient and make them more willing to go on the hypnotic journey.
If I do this, what will we do?
We will journey into your mind. We will find the source of your pain.
Josephine locked eyes with me.
You will be with me?
It was a question, a plea, and on the outside edges, it was a command. She was a woman used to being obeyed. I will be with you the entire time. I will not leave your side.
My mind is a dangerous place, if my nightmares are any indication.
It was a challenge. I nodded. That may well be, but I will not leave your side while we are in session. You are safe with me. This was a promise I gave all my patients, and I held my promises dear. A smile was brittle.
I do not believe that is true, Doctor, but I believe you are sincere.
With that, she unbuttoned the cuff of one sleeve and pushed both the sweater and linen fabric up, exposing her forearm. She offered it to me. I didn't hesitate. I prepared the sedative and administered it. All the while, I spoke, part distraction, part information. In my research, I came across a scholar who investigated the way the mind reacted when presented with the impossible. Miracles, magic, the supernatural. When we are young, we accept these things because we don't know that we shouldn't. The same thing happens in dreams. When we are older and we are presented with such, we reject it until we have no other explanation. In dreams, we revert to a childlike state of acceptance of the impossible because our minds do not let us know it is impossible.
This is what the hypnotherapy will do?
Yes. I pressed a cotton ball to the injection site before covering it with a bandage. I even helped her straighten her sleeve and button her cuff, as if I were a stand-in for Hannah. If we are expecting something miraculous to occur, it is as if our minds regress to an innocent state of acceptance. Thus, when the event happens, we accept it without question. I dimmed the lights until one light shone above and behind Josephine. This is what I want you to do. I want you to acknowledge and accept every thought that comes to your head as we journey. No matter what you think, you will be safe. I shall be by your side.
Do you promise?
Josephine's voice already had the soft quality of one relaxed. I saw her slump against the comfortable chair. Her dark brown eyes watched me from under heavy lids.
I promise. I won't leave your side while we're in session.
I picked up the light enhancer from the coffee table, a device I had invented to help my patients go under. It was a little more than a wooden frame with a metal disc suspended in the middle by a thin wire. I sat down across from her. Focus your attention here, on this disc, Josephine. I set the disc rocking back and forth. The moving light played over her face. Josephine smiled.
No watch?
No watch, I confirmed. This is therapy, not a sideshow act. No need for a flashy watch to catch the eyes of both an audience and a participant. Just this. Just you. Just me. Focus on this light and let your thoughts wander. Let them go where they will. If your eyelids are heavy, let them close. She closed her eyes, opened them once, and then closed them again. I kept my voice low and smooth. A consistent monotone was the key until the patient was under.
Remember, you are safe with me.
Safe. Josephine's voice was soft and asleep. The sedative mixture worked quickly. I lowered the light enhancer to my lap.
We are going on a journey.
I want you to think about the last 3 weeks. Think about them as if they happened to someone else. There is a sheer veil between you and the memories. When you remember, it will be as if it happened to someone else. They cannot touch you. Do you understand, Josephine? It cannot touch me. Her chest rose and fell in regular slow breaths, calm and serene. Go deeper, Josephine. Sleep. Let your thoughts take you where they will. When Josephine did not respond, I waited and counted her slow breaths. On her seventh breath, I asked, Josephine, can you hear me? Yes. Her answer was an exhale of breath. We have begun our journey. Where are you? I am approaching the 70 steps of light slumber. I paused. That was a peculiar turn of phrase. I had never heard before. It seemed specific and important to Josephine. Describe where you are. Tell me about the 70 steps of light slumber. I walk the path of stone toward the stairs. On either side of me is the mist. I can hear things in it. I watched Josephine's face. She appeared more than just relaxed. She was comfortable with her surroundings. How do you feel? I feel fine, thank you. The response was automatic. I know this place. I have been here before. Josephine paused for a long time, her head twitching back and forth. Where are you? I am right here, Josephine, right by your side. Not there. I need you here. You promised. The stairs are just down the path. I need you with me. My frown matched hers. I didn't understand. I put the light enhancer on the table and reached out to cover one of her hands with my own. I'm right here, Josephine. She flipped her hand over and grabbed me by the wrist in a grip stronger than I expected. There you are. Come. We need to go. There is something I must do. I winced as the light above Josephine's head shone bright in my face. Then, gravity shifted and I was falling through a rainbow of colors. Before I could cry out, my falling body shifted and I was flying. I could see Josephine's hand on my wrist, but nothing else of her. All around me, colored light pulsed and shimmered in undulating waves. Gravity reasserted itself as my head spun and the world tilted sideways. My body, crouched forward as I had been sitting on the edge of the chair, stumbled forward in an effort to keep me from falling. The chair was gone. Josephine grabbed me by the shoulder. It kept me from tumbling to the ground, but not from banging into the hard wall that hadn't been there moments before. Dazed, I pulled back from my patient and the wall. I stared. I was not in my office anymore. I didn't know where I was. I hugged myself, blinking and gasping, trying to make sense of what had just happened. We were in a stone corridor without any windows or doors. The air was fresh with a faint tinge of wetness. It reminded me a little of the asylum, but the smell was wrong. Wetter, loamier. I looked for the lights, saw none, and wondered how the hallway was illuminated. The walls were cool and moist to the touch. More importantly, they were solid. It was impossible. The wet chill, so familiar and so different from the normal atmosphere of the asylum, told me otherwise. All my senses told me I was here, in this new, unfamiliar place. Josephine stood halfway between me and the darkness at the end of the hallway, a hallway that hadn't been there before, one I didn't recognize. Where are we? She tilted her head and gave me the kind of look you give a particularly slow student when the answer is obvious.
The Dreamlands, of course.
I walked to her, noting that she no longer wore a dress. Instead, she wore the kind of thing a working archaeologist might wear in the field. Pants, boots, shirt, gloves, belt with canteen, and a vest. Everything had changed. I was still in my usual work attire. Long skirt, blouse, warm suit jacket, stockings, and sensible shoes. I was the same as before. I don't understand. We were in my office. Josephine let out a slow breath.
We don't have time for this. I have a task to perform.
What task? My mind spun, confused. We'd just been in a therapy session in my office. How had we gotten here?
Once we get down the stairs.
She turned and walked down the corridor. I rubbed my face and looked again. The stone corridor was still there. I followed her at a slower pace, grappling with this turn of events. Perhaps my foray into anomalous thinking put me into a similar hypnotic state. Perhaps that was what was needed with Josephine's case. I struggled to put myself back into the doctor's state of mind, to regain my equilibrium. Josephine, describe what you see. She stopped and turned to me.
You see what I see, don't you?
You mentioned mist before. I don't see mist.
Oh. Well, there is a stone path. It is black and worn, but not dusty. All around us is mist and shadows within the mist. Above, there is a purple sky with blue-purple clouds.
She gestured to each area as she spoke.
What do you see?
I took a slow breath, working hard to remain calm, or to at least appear to be calm. I would not panic. I had my patient's mental state to consider. I see a long stone corridor that leads into darkness. I pointed down the hallway. It's cool and damp here. I don't know where the light comes from. I watched her with a keen eye to see what her response would be to the fact that I disagreed with what she said was around us. Her response was not as I expected. Josephine laughed and clapped her hands together with delight.
That is the Dreamlands. It is a bit different for everyone. Still, you see the same path I do, leading in the same direction. That is enough for now.
She turned away and walked toward the darkness. The farther she went, the more the darkness receded. I could almost see a door at the end of the hall. As I moved to follow her, a small hand touched my arm. Behind me was a child in tan shorts, white shirt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.